This episode is brought to you by coffeegram.com, bringing you premium single origin coffees available in beans, ground coffee, and espresso pods. This podcast is also brought to you by The Body Kitchen, providing athletes with macronutrient friendly meals across the UK. Head on over to thebodykitchen.co.uk and use the code MMA10 to receive a 10% discount on your next order. Hello, and welcome to the very first episode of the Coaching Futures podcast. I'm your co-host, Connor Duffy, and this is a brief introduction into the background of how this episode came to be. Steve O'Keefe, who is the host of this podcast, and myself have been planning this podcast for a fair while. We collectively have thousands of coaching hours and have coached a plethora of sports, age ranges, and ability levels. The mission statement of this podcast is not only to highlight the effort put in by coaches around the world, who often reside in the shadows of the superstar they sacrifice so much to build, but to also bring sound information and advice to current coaches and athletes, and perhaps help both master and student achieve a higher level. Coaching Futures aims to be the standard and the go-to when it comes to a coaching informative. There is a method, and all the information you will ever need to achieve the coaching goals you have will be found here. We ourselves have most of this information, and will militantly seek out every great mind we can that may have a gem of information, a feather for our proverbial caps that may enhance the knowledge, the standard, even further. We are so lucky to have for our very first episode, Rubens Charles, aka Cobrinha, considered in the Brazilian Jiu Jitsu world to be the greatest pound for pound competitor of all time. As well as being a world-class athlete himself, he has also coached world-class athletes, including Fabricio Verdum, former UFC and ADCC world champion. At the start of this podcast, I go through the accolades Cobrinha has achieved. The list is impressive, to say the least, but I believe it's his bulletproof mindset, concrete attitude, and watertight philosophy that you will find most inspiring. We managed to catch Cobrinha amidst his UK seminar tour, and had only a brief window of opportunity to sit down with both himself and his mindset coach, Eammon. In order to catch the notorious duo, we had to act fast, and in doing so had to sacrifice the visual element of our show, and focus on what really mattered, the words of the men themselves. All Coaching Future podcasts will involve a visual element, so hold tight. We recorded ad hoc in a studio gym, and apologise for any echoes or changes in volume between counterparts. So, without further ado, we present to you the first Coaching Futures podcast. Turn on your brain, sit back, be ready to learn. All right, hello and welcome to Coaching Futures podcast. Today we have in our midst the top pound for pound Brazilian Jiu Jitsu practitioners to have ever graced the tatami. A 5-time world champion in the gi, a 4-time, we're trying to get this right because he's correcting me before we started, a 4-time world champion in no-gi, a 5-times Pan Am champion, and a 3-times ADCC champion. The only man in his division to win the Grand Slam, which is both the Pan Ams, the Brazilians, the Europeans, and the Worlds in IBJJF, and he's also the first man in history across the board, across any weight class, to have won the esteemed Super Grand Slam. That's all of the above, plus an ADCC title. He's done that this year, and he's also been voted Athlete of the Year as well. We're very lucky to have him for just our first episode of this podcast. I feel a little bit kind of, a bit taken back, you know what I mean? He's literally gazing at me right now, like, you get any of this wrong, I'm going to choke you out. We've got Max literally right behind us as well. I'm a little bit scared. He received his black belt from Terre in 2005, am I correct?
2005, yes.
2005. And since then, he spent a little bit of time teaching at the Alliance Academy, and he's also opened his own academy. But he has medaled in every single major championship since then. Known for his attacking style amongst his offensive guard, Cobrinha opened his own school in 2011. And before that, he was a coach at Alliance headquarters. One of the most notable students is Michael Lange,
yes,
as far as I'm aware. And we are very lucky to have him, especially for such a notable guy, on our first Coaching Futures podcast. So I think where we start off is, we're going to start right from the beginning.
Yeah, we've also got with us Eammon, who's been working with Cobrinha for some years now. And I think that's where we can start. I think, Eammon, if you want to just speak about how you guys started working together, that's okay.
Yeah, sure. I got involved in mental performance work about 10 years ago now. And I first met Cobrinha when he came over to do a series of seminars. I think it was Champ Camp were hosting the seminars many, many years ago. They used to bring over Jiu Jitsu athletes and get them to tour the UK teaching seminars. And that's when I first met Cobrinha. I was newly awarded my black belt in 2010. And I was asked to come along to kind of support the tour across the UK. And that's when I met Cobrinha. And obviously having the opportunity to talk to an athlete with the mindset that Cobrinha had, I was just wanted to jump inside straight away and find out what made him tick and see if there was any way I could enhance that or make him aware of how he is so successful and in any way or shape or form assist his kind of journey. And that's how our kind of relationship began.
Amazing. Cobrinha, how did you find working with Eammon in the beginning and how it developed over the years?
First of all, thank you very much, guys, for having me here. I'm
thank
really
you.
Happy to be part of this. When I met Emo, I set the goal, which is it was the only title I was missing in my career was the DVCC. Then I went all the way to Barcelona. Yes, sorry, I'm in Spain, Barcelona, and then I fought the first time over there. And I lost in the final over there, yeah?
2009.
So I went all the way to the final, and I lost in the final. Then I came to England, yeah? And also, that's when I met Emo before, and I came to England, I told Emo, I'm coming to England, I'm going to compete at ADCC in England. Can you be there with me as well? I said, Cobrinha, yes, sure, I'll be there with you. And we went there, he was talking to me, and he was always telling me, Cobrinha, something, they want to talk to you, you got a great mindset, but I feel like something's holding you down, okay? So we're gonna work on that. And I said, and then every time you ask me questions, and I was telling him what I was thinking, and said, okay, well, are we ready for this? And I got to the final, and once again, and then we faced the setback once again, we lost the final. And then as I lost this final, I was talking to Emo. I say, Emo, you know, I think, what do you think we're missing? I mean, you know, I think the mindset's there. What do you think right now? What do you think you're missing? I told him, I said, you know, maybe the strategy, maybe something. He said, you know, we gotta just keep work on the mindset. I wanna just have the meetings with you. I'm here in the UK, you over there in LA. So what are we going to do? We're going to do meetings, right, through the Skype. That's what we were doing. And then I was talking to him. But before that, when I went back home, a lot of people were calling me saying that, Cobrinha, what's the reason? Tell me what's the reason you keep going through this? So you went into two finals, you lost already. And then look at your academy. Look what we have here. You have everything. I mean, you got a lot of gold medals, right, on a curriculum. You don't need this medal anymore. And then if myself, I'm very positive what I do in my life. I said, you know what, maybe you're right. You know, I have a look at my school, beautiful school, I have students, I'm successful with my school, I had the success as a competitor as well. Maybe I should, you know, quit, stop. That's the way I thought. And I went home and I slept on it, thinking about it. Woke up in the morning and I said, listen, no. I got, you know, the best coach in the world. I got the mental coach, strength coach, wrestling coach, jiu-jitsu coach. I can't let others be the director of my life. I can't. And then I woke up in the morning, I told my wife, I told Emo, I'm no matter what, it can take me 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, I am going to make it. And we start training again. And it was 2015. It was the ADCC in China. I did all my preparation, once again, talked to Emo, said, Emo, we're going again, and said, Cobrinha, just stick with this, stick with that, and then make sure, don't lose your focus. We went in 2015 in China, Beijing, excuse me, 2013 in Beijing, China, and we fought for 45 minutes in the final, and we won the first one, the first time. And the reason why I always tell this story is because people, sometimes they don't believe in themselves, and what they do, they come to you and then deliver the negative thoughts to you, which is like you tell them what you want to achieve And what they say to you, it's not possible. They're gonna try to plant that seed on your mind, which is, I don't think it's possible. You know, I think you should give up. You should move on, right? But it's your dream. What I tell people is that don't let others be the director of your life. You have to be the one who is the director of your life and keep moving forward, which means change the strategy, but don't change your goal. And long story short, we went over there in 2015, and we won this one. Not only that, they say no, we won the first one. That's the only title we're missing in my career. Then what we did, we went to Brazil, my hometown, São Paulo, and we won the second time in 2015. Yeah. And this year as well, 2017, I was telling people, I said, listen, this year, I'm going to compete, you know, the whole year. I'm gonna compete the whole year. Let's see how it goes. They say, no, yeah. You know, I can see the doubt because look at me, and then I'm 30, I'm gonna be 39 this year. And they say, you know, look, I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. I say, okay, so I'm gonna prove to myself it's possible. And we did everything. I told Emo, we're going to compete again at the DCC. It's gonna be in Finland. I would love to have you. You know, I mean, the team's gonna, all the team's gonna be there. The only one we're missing is you, Emo. You're coming. And he had a trip, right? He had the trip to South Carolina. He said, Cobrinha, this date, oh man, I got a job. I have to be in South Carolina. I said, really? So it was a bummer for me, but I say, no, Emo, it's okay. You know, it is what it is. You know, but he said, let me see how I can work around, and let's see what we can do. Yeah? And then 2 hours later, I got the message saying that, Cobrinha, I changed my flight. I'm going with you. I'll be there with you. That's, you know, because I was preparing for this, yeah, for the Super Grand Slam. And I say, no, I have everything what I need. Because I know when I feel, when I'm with Emo, because people, the reason I'm saying that, because some athletes, most of the athletes, they lack of that, the mindset training. They always train physically. They always train technical, but mentally, they lack of it. And I know that having him next to me, just like, you know, the way he is right now, next to me right now, I feel like superpower. I don't know why, but it's crazy.
I know that feeling, because I know exactly what you're talking about. That's why I like working with Eammon so much and having him around me at my fight. And it's more, what I've noticed about Eammon, it's the questions he asks that enthuse the mind a little bit. He'll ask particular questions to me, like, ask if I'm okay, do you need anything, are you ready? And it's just like, yeah, I'm ready. And I'm thinking in my head, yeah, I'm ready.
I think what you mean is empathy. I think you come across an extremely empathetic person, so it's genuine when you seem caring and you seem relatable. So when somebody's been, very much somebody who's been in your shoes, knows exactly what you're going through, but isn't just, yeah, yes, no, whatever you want, it's, no, I'm genuinely here.
You know, there's this conversation I always have with instructors or other coaches, and when you work with an athlete and they have that much trust in you, the only way you can give them the best of yourself is by, first of all, understanding that you're honored to be involved in their journey and their quest. And that you're going to be there to help them achieve their goal and to see them win. I definitely get something from that. But I also have this understanding that my objective is to do everything for that individual, so all they have to think about doing is performing. And whether it's just being sitting silently with you if you don't want to talk, to asking you the right question at the right time, or to just leaving you alone and just being in the next room that you can reach out to me if needs be, it's having that ability to do that. And I think what I do, especially with myself, I do a lot of self-reflection, and I make sure that if I'm asking a question or if I'm working with an athlete, it's coming from a place of confidence, and am I doing it to serve that person, or am I coming from a place of insecurity to pretend like I need to be there, or I need to say something, or I need to do something. And first or foremost, before any of the techniques that you learn along the ways and the education that I've studied with regards to the mind and kind of that psychological aspect, it's once you're authentic with yourself and you can get real with yourself, you can get to where the athlete is and they can see that generally, and then you can support them in the best way possible.
Yeah, so then we went there to Finland. And Eammon was there with me the whole time, and he didn't speak much. That's the one thing, it makes a difference. It's not something like keep asking you, keep the, you know, sort of like questions, like silence, and then he comes to you and asks one this question, which is like, you know, sort of like he's making you to drill, which is like you tell him what you're going to do, right? Or he's gonna ask you something and then you repeat and say, oh, wait a sec, it looks like he's unconsciously, he's making me to drill, what am I going to do with that? Which is like, it's amazing, right? And I was saying before, most of the athletes, they lack of it. They get over there, they freeze up. And when you froze up during the competition, not much you can do. Yeah. So we went there in 2017 in Finland, and then we won, which we call the Super Grand Slam, which is no one has done in history, right? And we made it together. That's one of the reasons why, because we started together. We started this journey together, and I want to make sure Eammon is there with me. Because I told him, Eammon, that's my goal. I want to get this. But then he was there with me when I faced the two setbacks trying to get the gold medal at ADCC. And it took me almost 6 years to get one gold medal, right? And almost 8 years to get 3 times gold medal in ADCC.
That's an absolutely amazing achievement. Is there anyone at the moment that you think might achieve that anytime soon?
I don't, you know, to be honest to you, right now, when they saw that, oh, Cobrinha, he has done, which is when someone has done, they say, oh, it's possible. I mean, they're going to try to do it, yeah? But it's a lot of strategy on that. You have to have not just, that's the reason why when I say, it's not just Cobrinha. I didn't do this by myself. I did it with my team, because by myself, I would not be able to make it. And people sometimes we think, oh, it's just the athlete. No, you have the team behind you, which is gonna help you to make that happen. So I feel like if someone get the strategy really well and get like a strong team behind him, he'll be able to do it. But it's gonna take a while.
Yeah.
Would you say you always had the skills? I mean, being you know, 38, nearly 39 years old, you've had the skills for a very, very long time. But it takes years of experience and the right people to create the mindset. You know, I always talk about it all the time, even when I personally teach, say to everybody, you've got the tools. You know how to escape that. You know how to escape this. You gave up 6 phases ago because in your mind, you let that person have that and you were defeated. And sometimes every now and then, it has that little brief peak. That's what we talk about, peaks in athletes, where both the body and the mind are working alongside each other perfectly. So would you agree with that? Like, you've always had the skills, but it takes for certain individuals, certain moments of time with your own personal maturity to create that perfect mix, to then apply that to a super grand slam.
Absolutely. I mean, the skills is one thing, yeah? So you got the skills, but again, if you're lacking of the mindset training, you're not going to get anywhere. Because if there's just the skills, I think it's not enough for you to achieve what you want. Because when you get over there, sometimes you have the skills, but you get over there and you start the fight. Let's say it's talking about the fight. If someone does something to you, which means what? They're planting the seed on your mind, which is like you feel like, oh, I thought I'm very skillful in this situation, but all of a sudden he did something to me, and that's when you freeze up right away.
Yeah.
And that's when it comes with the mindset. You say, no. He planted that seed, but I'm not going to let him water it. Which is gonna, it's not going to grow big on my head. What I'm going to do, I'm gonna press the delete button. I believe I can do this. That's a different story.
Yeah, I believe like when you're not as experienced in competition, and this is why I always say to a lot of people is, you could be amazing at jiu-jitsu in the gym, competing something completely different. If you have any insecurity in your mind whatsoever, somebody does a little tiny something and you take it very, 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 very kind of to heart almost, and you start playing with your mind. Well, he looks really serious, he's warming up. Yeah, he looks really good in his warm-up. He's doing some really good drills.
Yes, yes.
And then only like now, I found it not even as I competed more, because I competed as a child. It was as I became a man. And it was kind of like almost like a stuff in. You know what I mean? Like, so what? I've got confidence in myself. He can fluff his feathers all he likes in front of my face, but I have the confidence, and obviously with the people that you have with you as well, to go. It doesn't matter.
It doesn't. Yeah, I agree with you. And what the reason why I'm saying that, with, because people they get confused with the skills. But your skills probably helps. I know I'm sharp, my techniques are sharp, my card is sharp, everything's sharp. But we'll just forget one thing, the mindset. Because when you can warm up really well, and we're going against someone, yeah? And then all of a sudden, you're expecting, I'm gonna go over there and impose my game. But that person imposed his game first. And what's going to happen to you, yeah? Because the mindset is not on point. What's going to happen to you? You're going to crash. And then when you crash, it means what? You're going to freeze up. When you froze up, not much you can do. What happened with your skills? It's gone. So we learn the mindset. When you get a good mindset, we are there. Something goes wrong. What do? We press the lip button immediately and say, everything's going to be okay.
Yeah. You adapt.
Correct.
Yeah.
But you have to have this ability.
Yeah.
Come from where?
Yeah.
Mindset.
Yeah, it's so funny. We had this jiu-jitsu competition. It was a couple of months ago now, and I think both of my fights that I had at that competition, I think both of them I was behind until the last minute, and it's quite funny. You look up and everybody's freaking out, because when you're not as experienced in competition, you think you get disheartened very, very easily. You start doing the maths in your head. You go, okay, I'm 3 points behind. I've got 56 seconds left. I need to get this, that, and it starts getting overwhelming, and you get defeatist.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas as you get more and more experienced, you could be in a really, really compromised position, and all you know, I'll be okay. We'll figure it out,
yeah.
And not panic, adapt, essentially, yeah.
You're right, but the one thing I do, and I teach in my academy as well to my students, is that, so one problem at a time. Thinking about one problem at a time.
Yeah.
Because if you think, now he got 6 points, 7 points, 8 points, everything's against you. And your mind, you can have like a sharp mindset. You're gone. You're thinking like, he's 10 points ahead, and I have to submit. And the coach, sometimes the coach, they make a mistake from outside. You gotta go. They're panicking the athletes. As a coach, I'm not saying I'm the best coach. I'm not saying, that's the way they should coach. But what I do is that I tell them the time. Tell them, you're down by 2 points, you're up by 2 points, just look at the hand over there, look at your posture, something like that, key points, key points, that's what I tell my athletes. I don't keep screaming to my athletes, right? That way, confuse the athlete as well. And also, I tell them, hey, you have to see the whole picture, you have to see, which means like, solve one problem at a time. Don't think like you're going to solve three, I'm gonna put back the guard and immediately submit him. First, back to the guard, establish your guard, get the pit stop over there. Of course, the arm is there, go immediately for triangle, but set up the, what you're going to do, set up the submission, yeah? Set up the bait, right? He's coming to you, he's not coming to me, now I have to adapt a little bit. And going back to what I was saying, solve one problem at a time. That's, I tell people, that's the way I have been competing my whole life.
Just slow it down and,
but when you can.
Yeah.
Because again, sometimes people say Cobrinha, but they are moving. Of course, sometimes you can see my mats, I'm going fast. But sooner or later, and that moment is gonna be the pit stop, which is like, now you are in my game. You gotta move the way I want you to move, right? Unconsciously. Right? But again, it comes with the mindset as well.
Yeah.
Mindset has to be sharp and point. It has to be trained as we drill every day. Am I right or not?
Of course, every day. I mean, going back to what you were saying about the coaching and the cornering and the panicking from the side of the mat, your student is going to manifest your state of being. And I like to think about the child. When a child falls over, or your child falls over, and you go, yay, what does the child do? They start laughing and they get up. But if you start going, oh my God, what does the child do? They start crying. And it's the same. We have to make sure that we have this calm demeanor. And it's amazing to me, number one, how many coaches are shouting from the sideline, and specifically in MMA these days, in the lower ranks, they're just screaming, and they're emotionally charged when they're cornering their athletes, and you're not going to get the best result or you're not going to get the best performance from your athlete if you're talking to them like that.
I think Greg Jackson was the kind of, he was the guy that kind of coined the, he'd get a fighter in his corner. Okay, give me three deep breaths. And the information he's actually given them is very, very minimal.
Exactly.
Me and my old lads, he's an absolute MMA nut like me. So kind of a Sunday tradition of ours is to sit down and watch UFC on a Sunday morning after it's been on a Saturday night. But we always make a comment, every time you see a fighter go back to the corner, okay, I need you. When he steps forward, give him a right hook. Then when he comes over the top, okay, you give him about nine different things. Mm. He's getting punched in the face. Because this is a stressful environment right now. And he has nine things to think about. Whereas Greg Jackson, three breaths, get your heart rate down. Okay, when he does this, start doing this. You good? Good. Off you go.
Mm.
And they can execute that.
I think you can really see that come out in... I think not just in MMA, Eammon, but in, I think in jiu-jitsu competitions, I think me and you have both seen people screaming at their students on the mat, like kids, oh God, those competitions are the worst when you're seeing the jiu-jitsu coach scream at the kids who are like 10, 11, 12, and then swearing as well on the sideline, and like credit to the hosts of the competitions, they often nip it in the bud, but that shouldn't be a problem in the first place. And obviously me and Eammon corner athletes together as well, and I think we've got a good dynamic in terms of we're both in the same kind of mindset. We're both very calm people. We don't talk over each other. We've been referred to as a Formula One pit stop team, and it's just like we go in, it would be take three deep breaths. Okay, one of us talks, we stop, the next one talks, stop.
Yeah.
And there's not, you're right, you're giving someone 10 things to think about, one is going to happen.
Mm.
One of those things.
Well, here's the question though, when is the fine line between, I always think that, when's the turning point in a fight when your fighter's losing and they need to throw caution to the wind and get it going? I mean, I've had it from you, there's the calmness, and there's that, you get your S together, because you know what I mean? And for me personally, I like that. It will kind of make me go, oh yeah, okay, yeah, you know, you stop sulking. When is that? When is that line?
It's very interesting because it all comes down, Cobrinha and I were talking this morning about this, and it all comes down to that awareness. You have to have the awareness to give the athlete what they need when they need it. And sometimes you have to break all of the rules because that's what they need in that moment in time. To maybe they've gone into a zone, or maybe that whatever it is, you need something to pattern interrupt and wake them up from the state that they're in so that they're doing something different. And maybe that means raising your voice, which you never normally do. Maybe it means telling them a negative phrase, which you never normally do. But if you can get them to shake them up and reset, then you can start giving them that information. And also delivering it in a way that's a sense of urgency. Like, okay, we need to work very quickly. And you know, maybe sometimes you have to throw a swear word in there, but sometimes you do have to break those rules.
Eammon, do you think that comes down to like understanding your athlete and how to deliver that information?
Very much so. You have to understand your athlete as best as you possibly can, and understanding when you get the best results out of them, when you talk to them in a specific way, what tends to happen, and whether that be in the training camp, and or whether that be just in a day-to-day basis. I mean, I have this philosophy that I don't really corner anyone that I haven't been involved with or had conversations with. It just doesn't make any sense to me, because number one, I will never step into your corner or support you if I don't believe you're going to win. And the only way I can believe you're going to win is if I was there talking to you or seeing you perform or seeing you train. Otherwise, I'd be doing you a disservice. I guarantee you for a fact, an athlete's going to feel, even by you just standing there, they're going to feel if you believe they win or not at a subconscious level. And if you're not emitting that vibe of yes, you've got this, then forget about it.
Do you find, I've been in some really chaotic, I would say, coaching kind of setups, where I find that the athlete is in a kind of suspended sense of chaos because they're getting that vibe from their coaches. So it's only because you just said about they're subconsciously getting that vibe of that they're going to win from you. I've seen firsthand where it looks like the athlete is kind of getting the vibe that this is a 50-50 situation. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
The coach is a bit like, well, you know, it's just, we're going to see how it goes, and you know, and it's all a bit For me, MMA is very serious, especially because it has there's dire consequences potentially. Mm. Any contact sport, there potentially is. So if you are unprepared, both physically and mentally, you may, you know, be getting in trouble. I've never understood the concept of going in unprepared, in sense of when coaches are very slap dash. So I drive past several gyms to go to Steve's, you know, on a daily basis. And I tell everybody that I do that. People ask me, where do you go? I say, I tell them where Steve's gym is, and they're like, but you live next to like three other gyms. I'll drive past them every time. Because for me, there's that coaching setup of, I feel like I'm playing for Man United. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So I have that confidence when I step on the mats, just the organization of a coach being there. Like, I don't feel like I'm looking after my coach. Does that make sense? How many coaches are maybe not ready to coach, too young? And then that they kind of transmit that really chaotic vibe to then the athlete, right? And you feel like we're not here to have fun. Winning this is fun. But just participating in jiu-jitsu, getting choked out is not fun.
Mm-hmm.
Especially in front of people, right? I've had it done to me once before. I was like, never again. So do you find that? Do you still see it with high-level guys where they're coaching people and it's just all a bit all over the shop and they haven't really slowed it down or thought about how they're bringing athletes to a competition or a fight, for example? I mean, you've spent time with like guys like Fabrizio Verduzzo.
Yeah, yeah.
You've seen his coaching setup. What's the difference between his setup and, I mean, like we saw on the live stream there, you know what I mean, what their setups would be like?
I feel like the Verdun, right, setups, I feel like the difference between those I see around is that he trains jiu-jitsu, right, with me. He goes to Rafael Cordeiro, he trains striking over there, yeah, and then he goes to the wrestling practice as well. He trains wrestling as well. And then what we do later, we put everything together, boom, yeah? Instead of, he's going, oh, today I'm gonna do, today, jiu-jitsu, wrestling, and striking. It's hard for you to absorb everything. So I go over there, I do a specific training with them in jiu-jitsu. We drill, a specific training with Verdun. And then he goes to Rafael Cordero, exactly the same. He goes in wrestling, exactly the same. And then he goes to his strength conditioning, it's different. So, and then what we do, we put everything together. That's what I feel the difference, right, for him. And then also, whatever Eammon applies with me, with the mind training, what I do with him as well. I do with all my athletes as well. And I do, I have my son as well. And my son is one of, I can do the most because he doesn't have an option. He has to listen to me, right? We are 24/7 together. So he has to listen to me. So easier to sharpen up him, yeah? So that's what I do, and I'm a person who likes to learn, and whatever I learn, immediately I can't wait to talk to another person and apply it, because that's the way I drill, that's the way I learn. I learn something, and I want to apply it right away to someone, make sure like I'm delivering the message, I'm teaching the person something, but also I'm drilling on my mind to stick on my mind.
You, I'm assuming you're, so for me with Verdun, there was definitely a turning point in his career, right? And it was kind of when he beat Fedor, triangled him. Now I understand that he was receiving striking coaching, but something changed. I feel like I saw that. Something changed, and he went from a guy who was a good heavyweight, world class, to a guy who had the confidence.
Yes.
And I understand Verdun's about 40, isn't he?
Yes.
Some people just take a little bit longer as a man, especially heavyweights. They're usually very immature until a little bit later on in life. Did he just need time? Or what was the changing benefactor?
I think the change was when he came to me and said, he asked me the help, which like, he said, Cobrinha, I really want to become a champion. Can you help me? I feel like, you know, I say, Rudum, I have a good system, but I mean, look at your size, look at my size. So we have just to agree on one thing over here. Whatever I tell you to do, you're gonna look at me, he's gonna say, yes. If I tell you, go to the fifth floor and jump right now, you go over there and don't think twice, jump.
Okay.
You agree with that? Yes, I agree.
You've got a funny story about Fabrizio Verdun, haven't you? And how you two weren't always the best of friends?
Yeah, absolutely. I will tell as well.
Yeah,
please. But I'll tell. But before that, he said to me, he looked at me and said, the reason why I would say the size, because I'm not going to fight you. If you say no, I'll step back and we're not going to train you anymore. Okay? So, but if you say yes, yeah, trust me, we're going to become a champion. UFC heavyweight champion, but you have to trust. Then I was testing him. I said, first question I asked him, what time you like to train, brother? Tell me, what time you like to train? You know, Cobrinha, I like to play a video game. I like to, and I sleep a little bit late. Okay, cool. I was just, making my notes. Oh, you like to play a video game? You like to wait? I would like to, sleep late. Okay, good. Keep on going, please. So, how about around 11? Oh, 11. Okay, great. All right, 11 a.m. Boom, there. Okay. Now, what else more? Yeah. So, Saturdays. Oh, Saturday, Sundays. Family, okay, family. Good point, family, blah, blah, blah. Interesting, okay. All right, so that's what he told me about this now. So, 8 a.m., you meet me here at the academy. Oh, 8 a.m.? No, I said, excuse me, what did you say? Oh, no, yeah. 8 a.m., okay. Saturday, Sundays. If I say so, you do so. Saturday, Sunday. I'm going to tell you where we're going to meet at and you're going to be there. But you call me Saturday, Sunday, what time? What time? I'm going to tell you right now. 8 a.m. Oh, I say, listen. It's not a discussion. It's not a discussion. I'll tell you what I'm going to do and you're going to say, yes, sir, done. And then we're going to do it. I'll be there with you. I'll be doing it with you. We'll do it together. Right? And he said, whatever, all right, let's do it. And then that day, that time, I was doing the mental coach, right? Mental training coach. I was doing his strength conditioning, and also I was doing his jiu-jitsu, right? So three. And if I don't know if you guys remember that, when we fought Travis Brown in Orlando, and everybody, we were in the bus, everybody was looking at Verdun. He was tiny, but sharp, fast, right? Because we did them in the whole camp for 3 months, killing him, yeah? And when you get over there, everybody say, oh my God, that's the heavyweight? Verdun looks weird. I mean, he's too tiny. And he came to me and said, Cobrinha, see, people is telling me, I think maybe we pass it. We say, Verdun, no. Look at me. Do you trust me? Do you believe in the system? Yeah, Cobrinha, I do, I really do. You're sharp, you're faster, your mindset is sharp, everything is sharp. Let's see when you get over there. It's 5 rounds. You gotta do 5 rounds. And if you go back right now and watch this fight, I'm telling you now, what he did in that fight.
That was a defining fight, yeah. Mm-hmm.
He fought for 5 rounds. 5 rounds. It looked like he was 21 years old, 22 years old. And then not only that, one time we were practicing, I don't know what we call that. One thing, like we bounce on your back and jump back on your feet. What do you call that?
Like get up, I guess.
He said, Cobrinha, I want to do this. But I say, okay, so we do this, but not during the fight, okay? Don't do this during the fight. So no, I want to just practice. Okay, so we're going to drill. We drill there. If you know that, if you watch the fight right now, so one time he was down and the referee said, he was down and the referee said, stop the fight. Now get up.
Yeah.
He got up. When he got up, he was ready to go. And then he kicked the Travis Brown. Boom!
Yeah.
But like a beautiful, like a ninja.
Yeah. I remember that specifically. He had a certain... Fabrizio was never that aggressive before. That fight, for me, when I watched that fight, he came out with... It wasn't reckless at all, but it was like a mental... It's like a mental change that he came out. He was aggressive. And I think, just from my... I'm 25 now. I'm only still learning about myself. But I think that comes from confidence.
Absolutely. But also, if you believe like the mindset is going to help you big time, yes. But the preparation.
Yes. Yeah.
That preparation comes first. Yeah, because when you prepare really well, And then you wake up with the tool, with the mindset.
Mm.
Oh my gosh.
Mm.
You feel like, trust me, you feel like unstoppable, because you look back and you did your homework. That's what I was telling him. And one thing I learned from Kenny Johnson as well, my wrestling coach, is that, Cobrinha, do your checklist. I say, what are you talking about, coach? Your checklist. I'm about to get there. I say, no, now today you're gonna learn one thing. I say, okay, coach, tell me your checklist. You being a good husband? Yes. You did your training? Yes. You just skip any training? No. You know what I mean? So which is like, did you dream a good training? Yes. Being a good husband? Yes. Good father? Yes. Did you skip any training? No. Did you train hard? Yes. Checklist. Oh, huh. Your mental preparation?
Mm.
Yes. Huh. I'm ready to go.
Mm.
You know what I mean? So that's the point, I think, comes. People think, oh, you start just my mindset. I'm gonna call Eammon. What I need to do, just talk, you know, just tell Eammon. Eammon's gonna prepare my mindset. I'll go over there and I'll fight, I'll win. No, preparation becomes before. Your preparation, your hard work. You did everything. You did escape. You did sabotage yourself during the sessions, right? During the training sessions. And then when it comes with the tool, with the mindset, you become unstoppable. You think that way, but that's the way we should think as we get in the cage, as we get facing someone in the jiu-jitsu, right, Matt? That's the way we have to think. If you don't think this way, don't step over there.
Yeah.
Right? Because people say, oh, but then you're being seen, sounds like you're being arrogant. No. It's self-confidence. You have to have it. If you don't have it, don't step over there.
I was talking to one of my students last night, and they were asking about my MMA fight coming up. And they asked about one of the fights that I lost. And I was like, I lost that before I even got in there. Like, I knew I was going to lose that one because I was thinking about losing it. Because I was underprepared. Because I was working, and I thought I was working too hard to train as hard as I needed to train. Where in reality, I'm working 2 or 3 times harder than I ever have worked. And I'm still training harder than I was training back then. But the fights that I've lost, I knew I lost them. And the fights that I won, losing has never crossed my mind.
Mm.
Like, not a second of doubt crept in those particular fights, because I knew how prepared I was. And I felt like you just said, I felt unstoppable. I felt like nothing was going to stop me.
Don't you feel? So I spent like a few years doing strength and conditioning coaching a lot of, a lot of young athletes, right? I always find, so for me personally, when I was a young man, 18, 19, I always missed the preparation. I wouldn't drink, I wouldn't go out, I would make sure I got my sleep, I would work, I would train all the time. I basically lived at the gym. And when it came to competitions, I would crack. And I'd crack every time. I would give up, essentially. And it was almost like I felt like, because I had done everything so well, that it should have been easier than it was. So I should have walked in and just decimated everybody on the mats. I thought I was going to be an MMA world champion, but I thought because I had trained so hard that it was, in fact, the fighting part was going to be easy, and hadn't actually prepared myself for the fight. Basically, after that, I became worn out because I was so strict for such a period of time. I didn't really enjoy my sort of late teens. I just was in training, always living the life of a monk. And then what happened was, Steve sometimes will have the opposite problem with me, is because I'm sometimes reluctant to allow myself to that level of dedication again. Because for me, I got so mentally drained. It was almost like a breakdown afterwards, you know what I mean? It was almost like a release, like I couldn't hold that intensity for so long. Do you find that there's a balance? Because for me, that I always talk to people, especially young people, that I feel are very much like me. Probably a young narcissist, very self-obsessed, I say sustainable intensity. Do you think that's a thing? Or do you think that, am I just thinking about it negatively? Do I need to change my way of thinking personally and think about it? That level of dedication is actually, in fact, a positive thing. Like, I'm glad that I'm doing that, as opposed to me punishing myself. I felt like it was punished, like self-punishment almost, by being that dedicated 24/7. What do you think about that?
You know, I'm very suspicious to talking about this situation. Because what you just said right now, that's Cobrinha. I don't know what socialized means, because I have a goal, I have priority in my life, and I want to become a champion. So to become a champion is gonna cost. It's a cost. There is a cost for you not to be just a champion. I'm saying just in life, there is a cost. When I say it's a cost, is that you say, you know, it sounds like now I don't party, I don't do this, I don't do that, because you know that it's a waste of time. If you want to party, it's different. That's your priority, is to party. If you want to become a champion, you will have to think, read more books, thinking about how you're going to involve your game a little bit more. And some people, they say, you know, oh, I can do both. I don't believe in that, because that's me. That's I'm talking, I speak for myself. That's the reason why I say, sometimes I feel like, I say, no, I should not say that, because Cobrinha is this way. I set my goals, and no matter what, I'm going through it. That's my goal right there. I don't change my goal at all. I change the strategy. If I don't have to socialize, people call me, when I was brown belt, I remember like today, like you're saying that, I remember like today. I was going down, right, on my apartment, I was going down the elevator to train. And those guys were with me over there in the camp. They were about to get in the elevator to go up to rest because they were coming for the party. And they were talking, hey, let's see that girl, let's see the way we were dancing, blah, 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 blah. And in my mind, I was just like focusing on my training. And my question for you is that, how many of those made it? Who were with me by the time? 2. And we were over there and 12. 12 people. 2 of them made it. And I'm here telling you the story. Mm. Because of what? Because of the focus. Saturday, no time, no days off for me was like, people had to tell me, Cobrinha, I think you should rest. Which is like, I believe that's one thing I believe. Rest, it's part of the training. Resting is part of the training. Yes, it is. But talking about the socialized life, I wanna drink, I wanna party. It's not a good combination, whatever you wanna do in life. Because I feel like the knowledge is there for everyone. Who's willing? Who's willing to chase it? Who's willing to spend more time and read more books? Who's willing to someone ask the advice and then actually do it what the person told you to do it? Right? It's not everybody. Everybody wants to succeed. Everybody wants to succeed, but that is a cost. And sometimes it's high. The cost is really, really high, which is like you were saying. Sometimes they will say, like these days, I feel like for myself, I can speak for myself. That's what I have been doing, because that's the goal I set up for my life. I said, no matter what, people's gonna call me, Cobrinha, I have the party here, or I have this, or I have this, come with me. I say, no, that's my focus. Even when I focus, I say, I want to one as a black belt. Yes, one time. I want to one as a black belt one time. Right away, right when I won in 2016, in 2006, excuse me, 2006, when I won in Brazil, people were thinking, oh, let's celebrate, let's do a party, let's do this. My celebration, okay, so I'm gonna get a nice meal. Now I'm thinking already, 2007, how am I gonna do it again? How am I going to do it better? See the mindset? And I did in 2007. 2007, same thing, you know? I have the recipe again, right? I have the recipe. So what I'm going to do, I'm gonna eat a nice meal once again. Now I'm have to make the strategy. How am I gonna do 2008? And you guess what? With that in 2008 again. So it go on and on and on. So, but then that is when the cost is that people say, but now look at me. Like for me, if people calls me, oh, you know, when I come to my party today, I have a party, I think like twice or three times, because it's hard for me to socialize with. I like it, but even it has to be very, very friendly environment. And then what I do, I analyze it first. What are the benefits for me to be there? You know what? Who's going to be there? I ask people, who is going to be there? And they know me already. They already tell me, somebody's gonna be this person. Okay, so then I go, oh, you know, it's not much to gain from that. I don't do it.
Do you have like the almost like a clock in the back of your head? I have this thing personally, it's like, I was talking to you about this, is that when you've had a childhood of martial arts, that level of discipline, that ill discipline you see as almost like a waste of time, right? So when I'm doing things that could just be randomly socializing for the sake of socializing. You're not getting anything out of it. You just, if anything, it's just kind of like getting in the way. You feel like you've got like a clock on in the back of your head, like a timer, like, so this is 8 hours wasted, and now tomorrow I can't get up as early and then go do that training, and then that's when they're going to put that off. And you find yourself sitting there in a social occasion, everybody's just, relax, enjoy yourself. And you're like, no, because I'm not going to be able to get that run in, and I want to be able to do that run in that time. And then I'm like, is that, because I sometimes confuse that, and I think I'm just being self-obsessed. And I'm, you know what I mean? But is that just a habit of dedication, you know what I mean? Is this a positive thing?
I think so. I think it's a great habit to have. It's a great habit to have. Because again, it's your time. You have to manage it really, really well and maximize it. That's what I try to do. I'm not saying my system is the best, and then I feel like that's the way it works for me, for Cobrinha. And that's the way people ask me, what do you do? What I need to do to succeed? I say, listen, that's what I did, that's what I have been doing, and that's what I've done, right, to succeed, to get to where I am today. And that is a recipe. When I say a recipe, because I used to be a bakery as well, I used to be a chef, and over there, what we do, we find the recipe, we write down that recipe, it's working beautiful. That cake, we don't change that cake much. What we do, if you want to modify that recipe, we modify on the side, but that one we leave on the side because you know that one works perfect. And what we do on top of that one, which one works perfect, what do? We try to modify and make another one. That works perfect, we move on. Works perfect, we move on. That's what we do in bakery. And then what I do, I try to learn that system and apply for my life as well. Mm. And also for jiu-jitsu as well, right? That's what I do. Right, and I feel like it works perfect. But what we do sometimes in life, we do this. We, if like to achieve our goal, we do one time, and then someone's gonna tell you the recipe, and what we do, I'm gonna modify right away. without try it. Or sometimes they try it for 6 months. Oh, see, it's not for me. It's not for me. Or they try for a year. Oh, see, it's not for me. See, that way it's not for me. It's not for me. Instead of, I have that goal, I'm gonna modify my strategy, but I'm going to get right there.
Yeah, I mean, there's a few things that have been touched on there, which is, I mean, for me, I've been blessed with working with many athletes, you know, from amateur to professional to champions to over many sports. And what I notice is those that win at the highest level, for them, the journey is a way of life. They're not just a champion for that short period of time. They're a champion in everything they do within their life. From how they tidy their room, to how they manage the relationship with other people, to how they train. And they don't see it as work. And for me, when I'm talking to an athlete initially in the first conversation that I have, if they're looking for some kind of support, is I'm asking them, why do you do this? I'm looking to understand why they do this and to kind of get to see what's motivating them and what's pushing them. And alarm bells start ringing for me when they see the journey as work. Because the moment they start referring to it as work, it's not sustainable. It's not sustainable. It has to be an enjoy. It has to. I remember asking Cobrinha, just checking in, like, how's the cut going? I'm fantastic. What he used to say to me in Finland. I'm like, great, we know we're on the you know, and with that enthusiasm, we're all good. Not, I'm struggling and I'm so hard. I could never have imagined that coming out of his mouth or with certain athletes that I'm working with. Of course, it's tough, but when you're asking an athlete how the cut's going, and my cut's amazing, I know those guys are struggling, then you're laughing. You know that you're winning.
Do you find that guys who aren't quite, maybe, I don't feel like they're maybe as mentally sound as they could be. They talk about their weight cut a lot, as in like this is a huge deal, you know. So how's things? Yeah, you know, just doing this weight cut. Like it's a big thing, you know?
No, I tell you what, it's when they start talking about the weight cut as separate to the competition.
Okay.
So what I mean is, oh, I love fighting, but I don't like cutting weight. That is the that is it. I like winning, but I don't like training. It doesn't make any sense. It comes part and parcel, and you have to embrace all of it as a whole. I like playing jiu-jitsu and I like being in top position, but I hate it when someone takes my back. All of these are alarm bells. every position is a position. It's a situation that you have to deal with. And it may not be the most optimal situation for that moment in time, but you have to embrace it as part of the game as a whole. Because the moment you separate those is the moment you start having issues. And I remember saying to Cobrinha, what's your best, very at the start, which is your best position in jiu-jitsu? Do you remember what you said, Cobrinha? When I said, what is your best position in jiu-jitsu? You probably don't remember our first ever conversation.
In Finland?
No, way back when we first ever met. I asked you, what is your favorite position in jiu-jitsu?
Yeah,
he probably doesn't remember. He said, all of them.
I feel comfortable, yeah.
Yeah, he said, all of them. You can be on my back, I can be passing your guard, I can be in your guard. I love them all the same. Apart from 50-50 back then.
Yeah, right.
And then he said, and then we just started working on the 50-50 position. But
see, I love 50-50.
But it's just how you perceive it. But then again, even though we said that in jest, I realized that 50-50 was something we had to address because Mendes used to play that a lot. So there
just,
was...
Just so positive. This is the vibe I'm getting. I mean, I even got that vibe before I even met you. Just following you as a... You know, dude, I was watching when I was 18, 19, when I wanted to be the next Jiu-Jitsu world champion. And it just seemed to be like, it was like, you see it so often, guys get to the top, they like lose and they kind of just fade away. And I'd see you come up like, oh, Cobrinha's won this. I'm like, huh? What keeps this guy away? Like, is he just, and you always be smiling, like competition day, be smiling. And it was almost like you were just happy to be there. And it was like, oh, he's just happy to be here. He's like, no, he's winning everything. Like, this guy's the man. And it just seems that, when I think maybe just an experience, I think it's actually people talk about age, right? Oh, you know, he's 38. I think it's a good thing because maybe if you were 28, you wouldn't have that same bulletproof mindset that every time you come across any hurdle, it's like, okay, well, so what's the solution? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
As opposed to that's my excuse, that's my way out. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I feel what I feel sometimes with athletes, because again, people ask me, what's the reason you're saying that? What I'm going to tell you now, it's self-sabotaging.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Self-sabotaging, it happens all the time. And I can, as soon as I start talking to the athletes or walk with my with athletes all the way to the to corner them in the MMA or jiu-jitsu, whatever, I can see it. As I'm looking to them, as I'm talking to them, I see if they are losing self-confidence right away, which is sometimes what we're trying to do, you know, my weight cut. When they start talking about my weight cut, what are you talking about, a weight cut, right? So I mean, no one pushed you to be there. No one told you to be there. So you're there because, you know, you want to compete, but then you're trying to give an excuse already if you lose. You know, it's because the weight cut. Or because, oh, you know, I feel like I feel a little bit my arm here. Or, you know, I feel like, oh, my something.
Yeah.
It's self-sabotaging.
It's kind of like going for a test, is it? Was it one guy who says before the test, oh, I didn't do any revising. So it's that kind of, so if I lose, if I fail this, I'm not dumber than you guys. I just didn't revise.
That's
does that make sense?
You know, it does, the same thing happens with anything, life, anything. We sometimes we give this type of excuses. It's because it's self-sabotaging. But sometimes we don't know. We want to just to get to, like, I'm going to tell Eammon, you know, I don't know. Eammon's going to say, how's your weight cut? I feel like, I don't know, Eammon. I feel like, you know, weak. You know, I don't know. I mean, I'm giving him an excuse already. And then now I'm expecting to Eammon to go to my coach over there, Kenny or the other one, and say, listen, I feel like, opening, you know, I don't know. You feel like weak. If you're like, you know, he doesn't feel well, and I know everybody's aware, right? If something goes wrong, no. The responsibility, it's mine. He comes to me, probably, how are you feeling? It's amazing, because I know that. I did everything to be there. Self-sabotaging, to me, it's not going to happen, ever. If it comes something to my mind, I press the delete button, because I have a goal. And my goal, and that day, and as soon as I step over there, I know that the only person that can stop me is myself.
It's the last 5%, right? It's the last 5%. It's 95% there. I spent years coaching people, trying to get people to, you know, lose weight and stuff, right? They'd always say the same thing. They'd lose a whole bunch of weight. A guy would come in, he weighs 120 kilos. He gets down to 95. Five more kilos, you're going to have a six-pack. Two more kilos, you're going to have a six-pack. they will always, 99% of the time, they will always fail on the last 2 kilos.
Yes.
Because allowing yourself to succeed is where everybody goes wrong. I say to a lot of people, I said, look at yourself. Now look at that guy on Instagram or in that picture that you absolutely idolize. What's the difference between you and him? Genetically? Nothing. But when he looks in the mirror, he sees him. When you look in the mirror, you don't see him, you see you.
Yes.
And you think that he deserves to be there and you don't. And that's the line.
I know exactly what Cobrinha is talking about, because obviously when you're preparing for a fight, especially an MMA fight, you get riddled with injuries. And these injuries can either make you or break you. And the doubt does creep in. And I've had Eammon ask me questions before, like, how are you feeling? And I'll be like, oh yeah, I messed up my knee a little bit, or my shoulders, or I'll get tendonitis in my elbow. Oh, tendonitis is playing up a little bit. Now I know that doubt creeping in. So when I recognise it, like you said, I press that button, I've got to try and throw it away. There's one thing Eammon said here, and it's one of his rules actually. We're actually in Eamon's academy in AONBJJ, but he's one of his rules on the wall, and it's don't complain about your injuries, because it will have a negative impact throughout the academy. I assume that.
Zico, right?
And specifically stories. It says do not bring your stories in here. And a story is something you make up that is not fabricated or real. We don't talk fiction in here. We keep everything as reality. So I don't want you coming onto the mat and like, yeah, how's things going? Oh, you know, I had a really tough day. That's not allowed in here, in this environment. This is a pure environment for growth and learning. So we have to make sure that the environment reflects that. This is a nurturing environment. Of course, if there's a severe injury and you break a bone, we're not going to say continue rolling, but we want to make sure that we're nipping things in the butt, because you might have just slept funny, but you're telling everyone that you need a surgery in your neck, and that's how it starts.
How many times is that wrong with a guy? And he goes, oh yeah, just wash the shoulder, right? Wash the right shoulder.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, in the heat of the moment, am I going to be able to determine which one's left and right? But you're going, okay, yeah, no worries, right shoulder. And then you slap hands, you bump fists, and they're going at 100%. So what he basically said was, just quickly before we start, if you beat me, it's because of my shoulder.
Yes, exactly.
That's it. This is where it happens all the time. And what Eammon just said at my club in Los Angeles, I collect the cards, which are tennis cards, for everyone, each one of my students, and I shake their hands. It's exactly the same. Always I ask them, how are you doing today, Robert? And Robert's going to tell me, hey, you know, I'm okay. I'll be there, I'll spend like 2 minutes or 3 minutes over there with Robert. If I need, in two, Rob's gonna tell me, yeah, now I'm feeling bad. Tell me why you're not feeling well. You're here, look at the place, look how beautiful it is. You're here to have fun. What's wrong? Tell me what's wrong. You know, yeah, you're right. Don't you think I have problems as well? Do you think I come over here and teach you guys, I don't have a lot of problems, I don't have a lot of obligations as well, like you? But tell me, what's wrong now? And then all of a sudden say, oh, you know, I didn't think this way. You're right. And then Robert goes over there and starts training, you know, relax. So that's something like we have at my club as well. Because my goal is to make sure everybody's there in a good environment, just like Eammon just said. So whatever problem you have, we don't talk about your problems.
Cobrinha, I just want to go back to you winning the Super Grand Slam.
Okay.
Now, we spoke a little bit about I asked you if you thought that there could be anybody else in the next couple of years that you think might achieve something similar, or maybe in the next 2 years, maybe in the next ABCCs, do the same thing. Now, I'm reading a book called The Talent Code. I don't know if either of you have read it.
Mm-hmm.
And
I told you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it talks about when the first guy broke the 4 minute
mm-hmm.
Miles. Yes.
But then as soon as that 4 minute mile was broken, it weren't long after, the next guy broke it, So do you think you achieving what you have is going to inspire people to do the same thing and be like, okay, that's what I'm missing. Like, you found the recipe.
Yes.
Yeah, you're the master baker, you found the recipe. But now everyone else is going to be like, that's what I'm missing. Do you think Rafa Mendes now is going to be like, right, he's achieved something I haven't, I've got to achieve that.
You know, he could, but he retired. Right, I mean, he has to come back. Maybe he comes back, you know, maybe I think he has everything to do with it. I think he's young, but I feel like, yes, I feel like the way we did, because, again, we made it, and the people would think, oh, it's possible. You know, I thought it would not be possible compared the whole year, and also doing the ADCC, which like I feel like is one of the toughest competition ever, right? It's ADCC. It's again bringing back is the weight cut and the training, because you have to prepare for everything. It's a heel hook. I mean, everything. It's a lot, and especially for us, we are people who are used to just to train, just to compete in IBJJF. Totally different mindset you have to come for EDCC, because then it's heel hooks, everything's allowed. Everything is allowed over there. So, and also the weight cut, when I say the weight cut is that, it's because the weight cut, you have to cut weight every single day.
Yeah.
So Friday, you don't compete, but you have to make weight, okay? 66 kilos. And then what you do, you come back on Saturday, you have to make weight again. Yes, you compete, did you qualify for Sunday? Yes, I did. Go back again next day, weigh in again, 66 kilos, and compete again. So three times in a row, right? So I think it was one of the toughest competitions. That's the one of the reasons, not the preparation. I think that weight cut over there, three times in a row, and that's when you have to have someone like Eammon next to you to prepare, I mean, to keep your mindset sharp, because you can crash anytime.
Do you think Rafa Mendes has got it too good now? Do you think he's achieved a lot? He's got a nice academy. He's probably earning a good living a nice life. Do you think he'll think, okay, I don't need that?
You know, it's quite fun to talking about it. It's personal.
Yeah.
It's very personal. I know what I want for myself, but I don't know what he wants for himself. Right. So it's very, very personal. It's quite fun to talk about this, because again, it's. I know what I want, he knows what he wants for him. If he feels like, you know, some people think it's enough. It's enough for me, it's enough, right? And he achieves a lot in his career. And then if he thinks like it's enough, it's enough. But if he thinks like he wants to come back in activity, I'm sure he's going to do well, I'm sure.
Yeah. I would like to see him back, like for the last, I suppose, 5 years. I've been watching guys like yourself, Michael Lange, the Mendes brothers, guys that really innovate jiu-jitsu, and I think the Vieira brothers, Ricardo and Leo, for years that they did that. They innovated jiu-jitsu. And I remember watching an interview, and Rafa Mendes was saying how the Mendes brothers inspired him because of how innovative they were with jiu-jitsu. So it'd be really nice to see him back, and I'd like to see him compete again. It's exciting fights.
I don't think we see it enough though. So you've obviously got the secret. You've got the key, right? But yet, but I don't think enough people will be looking to you. So this is what happened with Conor McGregor. So everybody says, okay, they throw him, you know, he picked fights, he did this, did that. Okay, the guy won two titles in the UFC. There's a blueprint there. It's very valuable. In fact, it's worth millions and hundreds of millions of pounds of dollars. Follow that. Yet, when he was a coach in the Ultimate Fighter, he had all these different concepts that he follows through John Kavanagh. A lot of flow sparring is something that I've personally done before, is where you slow things down and think about where you're striking in the body, at what time, instead of just throwing. And yet people watch that and went, Anyways, back to kind of how we traditionally do things. So I think the fact that you've mentally broken that barrier, but I don't think enough people are gonna be, I think people get stuck in their ways. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
You know, people will even listen to this and then use the words you say to compliment what they already think, instead of thinking, okay, I need to go find him. Anything he does, I need to do. And I find, like, you must get guys every now and then will come to you and it's like, they found you, they've seeked you out. But how many guys really are there? You know what I mean? A handful?
Absolutely. Yeah.
That literally will devote themselves. You've got the secret. You know, a bit about when Forrest Gump's running around America and guys just start following him. You know what I mean? You need those guys. How often? Not very. The same with Steve. Like, Steve's got a blueprint here. And he starts teaching stuff or doing stuff a certain way. And guys, like you said, they start adding their own. I think, like, in the bakery, I've got my own stuff. What foundation?
Do you know what? Initially, when I first started this, like, years ago, 13, 14 years ago, I initially thought that anyone could do anything. And then, you know, I've had many conversations with Cobrinha about this, and not everyone can do this. Not everyone can be a champion, because everyone has their different journey to take, and sometimes they have their different reasons for doing things. And I truly believe that a great champion has the desire to be the best ever, but also understands that losing is a possibility. And once they come from that space, they're willing to prepare any way they can to make sure that possibility of losing cannot happen. Whereas some people think that they're great at the sport and they're very talented, however, believe they don't have to work as hard because they're so talented and losing is not an option. And then when that loss comes along, they can't deal with it effectively and it blows them up like Ronda Rousey and there's many other athletes it happens to. However, look how Conor took his loss to Nate Diaz. It's like he went back in camp and he went to figure out that problem and solve it and ask what happened, where did we go wrong, and how can we make sure it never happens again? And that's the true sign of a champion.
So you need this is the whole conversation with Rafa Mendes. Sometimes when you seemingly find things easy, like for you, you've had that, as you said, with Barcelona, you've had that failure and you've had to come back and do it. So you've had the opportunity to fall in love with that process. Like you say, Ronda Rousey, she's never had that before in her life. So when it happens, it's this huge personal thing and you can never come back from that. I mean, you definitely say that losses, I think we're all gonna probably agree on this, but losses are definitely a key factor when it comes to making a champion, to have those losses.
You know, I feel like I can get the other way around. I feel champions, they know how to deal with setbacks.
Mm-hmm.
They know that. And the champions, they know that, like Emo said, there is a possibility to face the setback. But what we're going to do, we're going to fix what we need to fix. We're going to come back stronger. So that becomes with the mindset as well. Because some people, they are only champions when they are winning.
Mm-hmm.
It's easy. I'm the champion as well. I mean, I'm winning everything. I can be the champion. But I've been on the other side as well, which is like I just told you guys the story about the EDCC, which I was losing. And not only that, you're losing, but also it's this competition every 2 years. You have to wait 2 years to compete in that competition, right? But again, some people, they know how to be a champion when they're winning. It's not life. It's not life. Because no one in this sport or this business just win and win and win. They face setbacks before they succeed. And what they do, they figure out. And then they keep on going. But some people, when they face the setback, they crash because they know that, oh, I'm afraid if I face the setback, I don't know if I can get up again. I don't know that. And if you notice that I opened my academy in 2011, I could have said it's the time for me just to focus on my academy. No, I say no. I know that I'm not going to tell anybody. I know that I won't be able to train them as much as I wish, but I'll continue. I'll continue my path. I want to compete. That's my dream. I want to compete into again. Get this academy, get my academies going, and get my students ready to help also me to continue at the competition, continue competing at the competitions at the high level, right, in Jiu-Jitsu. That's what I did. And it took me a while, yes, it did, but I didn't quit. And I was facing setbacks here, setbacks over there, setbacks over here. I said, you know, I'm going to shake it off, and I'm going to keep on going. And that's the reason why I'm here to tell you today this story once again. For me, in my eyes, champions are the ones who knows how to keep fighting when they face setbacks.
Mm.
Yeah. I saw a thing the other day, I think it was on Facebook, it was Will Smith, and he was saying about that when you fail well, fail often, and fail forward.
Mm.
Like you can learn from it, but if you don't move forward with it, then it seems pointless. But if you're learning from it and moving forwards from it, I think that's what happened with me when I lost my MMA fights in like 2012. I lost, I failed, I learned, but I didn't move forward. But my mindset was different. I thought, okay, yeah, life's too hard right now. I'm married, I've got a newborn baby, my priorities are different. And I think that's what was wrong, was my mindset.
Yeah.
And I think over the years of training with my guys and taking them to competitions and fights and seeing their successes, that's what inspired me. And it was seeing, I tell you what, it was one of my fighters, Giovanni, and it was seeing his mindset and knowing the kind of stuff that he goes through every day, and I'm thinking, like, this kid's inspired me to get back in there. Like, there's no reason why I should not be doing this. I'm training with these guys every day. Like, there's no reason why I shouldn't be. And that's that. From that point, that's where my mindset changed. And still learning from my failures from years ago, even though it's 4 years later now, then I failed forward. Then I moved forward from it. But I didn't know that until that actually happened.
I remember going to just jiu-jitsu competitions, and leading up to it, I'd just be absolutely just slaying everybody in the gym. And you know, I was a talented youngster, and then I would go and definitely give up, because it was harder than what I had prepared. It, like you said, it didn't go my way, and it would become this massive thing in my head. So the first 2 minutes wouldn't exactly go my way. I wouldn't thrash the guy in 2 minutes, just ego. And then I'd spend 3 minutes sulking, run out of time. And I remember crying after a jiu-jitsu competition, actually crying. And I was actually with my old man. He was there with me, and he was actually really, really disappointed. And I felt, oh, he's obviously disappointed because I let him down. My mum actually explained to me later on, she said, no, it was the way you handled it. It was the way you handled yourself. Like, get over it. What, this isn't the end of the world? No, it's a jiu-jitsu match, you moron. You know what I mean? Like, you know, live to fight another day. You'll be absolutely fine. And that's something now. I mean, I took 3.5 years off of jiu-jitsu. I didn't really step on the mats for 3.5 years. I was basically done with it once I'd stopped. I'd got into just teaching strength and conditioning, and I wasn't sure if I wanted to get back into it. So I entered a competition. And I entered at super heavy. It was a no-gi comp, and I just sort of turned up, and I had a new mindset. I wanted to experiment with a mindset, kind of just what will be, you adapt, and I'm just gonna go see what this is about. And I ended up winning, and like one of the guys turned around to me, he said, oh, so where do you train? I went, right, I don't train, did a long time ago. And he was a bit like, what? But I didn't think it was silly, because I got my mind right. I knew I always had the tools. I mean, Steve will probably tell you, I was rolling when I was 13 years old, when it was still in a leisure center, and we had to go get the mats out before every session. I had the tools. It was that defining moment when you sort of come of age, and you actually know, you know, those fights I'd be losing, and I'm, this is okay, you know what I mean? Oh, I didn't warm up right. That's okay. I'll get through this, you know what I mean? Whereas before, it'd be like, somebody would call my name, it would be like 10 minutes before I thought I was up. Oh no, I haven't done my burpees. I can't win if I haven't done my burpees, you know? And then you'd kind of go on from there.
Cobrinha, who was the most influential coach for you as an athlete?
An athlete? You know, it's a great question, because I got many great coaches in my life, and it would be very unthankful if I just mention one, right? But I got first it was Mauro Pacifico, who took me from white belt into a brown belt, and then I had a pleasure to work with TDD, who gave me the opportunity. And after that, I had the pleasure to train with Fabio Gurgel as well. After Fabio Gurgel, I went all the way to Atlanta, Georgia, which is the Master Jacare, which is the Fabio's instructor as well. And then strength conditioning. I had an amazing coach, which is from Brazil as well. He helped me big time. His name is Vaguinho. Wrestling coach, I had Paul Creighton too as well. He's from actually I think he's from New York, but he lives in Atlanta, Georgia. That's when he started helping me as well. And then when I moved to LA, I started training with Kenny Johnson, which is an amazing coach. I've been training with Kenny Johnson for 4 years. Mental coach, you know, I got Emo, right? Which is, see, it's for me, it's a team. We have a team. It's quite difficult to say that one coach, right, was the influence in my career. I think all of them just brought a good thing to my life, and I don't take it for granted. I take advantage in a good way.
Connor, I think I found the recipe to bring your success, and it's all the names you just mentioned. So yeah, no, that's amazing.
We need to track these men down.
Yeah. I'd say one of my favorite moments ever of jiu-jitsu, I think it was, it was 2011-2012 European Championships, and Finfo had Tadale in the semi-finals. And he gave up the opportunity to go through to the final to fight Claudio Calasanz, and let Tadale go through, and took off the black belt that he was wearing and gave it back to him, because it was a black belt that Tadale gave Finfo, and he took off the black belt and gave it back to him, and that's I think I must have been a blue belt then, but that moment will live with me forever. Just and I didn't know about the background of the context of the background of the situation, and that made me look into it and look into Tadale's past. And yeah, that was really inspiring for me. And obviously I work with a lot of young people that are in very hard up situations. I work for an organisation called Fight for Peace, and we've actually got one in Rio, in Mare, in the favela there. And in fact, Verdum has been to visit the academy in Rio.
Oh, really?
So it's like that story there, just that will live me forever, man. That's probably my favourite moment ever of jiu-jitsu. And I was like, obviously Finfo, I love watching Finfo. I love his style. I love obviously he is a student under Ricardo Vieira as well. He was for a very long time. So I was watching the match. I was like, it's amazing. That's one of my favourite moments.
That's really, I know winning is important, but when it comes to a coach, those are the things you really remember. Is when your coach reaches out for you and does something to you, or as a coach, somebody reaches out as a student, gives that favour back almost, or returns the favour in terms of, you know, just gratitude. I think there's too many people in the world that teach because it just seems like a natural transition from being a student. But yet they don't really take into consideration that being a coach, everything you guys just talked about. You know, I'm sure there's guys out here that could teach arm bars and triangles and this, that and the other. But what you guys have is kind of like empathy for the students is really, it's invaluable. You can't really put any money on it. You know what I mean? It's just so rare. And I think it comes probably for a connection that you kind of bounce off of each other. You know what I mean? But yeah, you see it too often. Like I get it with you guys straight away, same with Steve. He's the only coach I've ever had that will message me if I don't go training. I've never had that before. He'll actually take offence to it if I don't go training. You know, if any excuse I give him, I could be, you know, swinging from a, you know, tree next to 50,000 volts or whatever at work, and he's sending me the emoji with the eyes looking up because he thinks
I'm that emoji.
Yeah, or the middle finger. Yeah, because he just assumes that I'm lying. And you know, you feel like you're going to let him down, but at the same time, it's extremely empowering. And I think there's too many coaches out there that are, so why are you coach? Well, I was kind of good at it, and I didn't want to get another job, so I coach. Well, do yourself a favour and remove yourself from that environment.
I think we touched on it earlier about coaches that are just coaches because they were athletes. And it doesn't necessarily mean they're a good coach. I've done seminars with world champion athletes that have won numerous world championships, and it was a terrible seminar. So we've got maybe 10 minutes left, and I just want to finish off by asking both of you a question. So Cobrinha, I'm going to start with you, and I want you to, what advice would you give to coaches to improve their coaching skills?
First thing I would tell the coach, they have to understand what they are teaching, and create a system and believe in that system, and the way you have to deliver it, you have to make sure, because sometimes you see it in one way, you want to make sure the students is seeing almost the same way you're seeing it, which is like sometimes it's quite difficult. Some people think to teach, I have to make sure I demonstrate it. That's the way they have to do it. No, some people, they're gonna learn in a different way. And we have to make sure we deliver the way, we have to understand the students to deliver the way they will learn, the way they'll pick it up, right? But that's what the advice I'll give to them. You have to have the understand the system and trying to deliver the system the easiest as possible.
So you need to, in terms to do that, you need to understand your athlete, don't you? You need to understand them, you need to know them well, you need to know their background, you need to know how they learn, for you to be able to best deliver your strategy to them. Because people learn differently, right?
That's correct, but I can mention you, if you have six athletes, 10 athletes, you're going to work just with them, easier for you to understand each one of them. But if you have 300 students, right, and you're training everybody, how are you going to understand 300 students, right? So you are only one. Then what do you need to do? You have to read. You have 30 students at the academy, you have to read them, but it has to be fast. You don't have that much time. So then you have to be a great coach to be able to deliver to 40, 30 people at the same time what they need that day. So it's different. So we can talk, we can stay with you talking about coaching, which as I was saying before, if we have 10 students, consistent 10 students, easier to make them a machine.
Mm-hmm.
When you have like 300 students, yeah, and then their goals are different. They are not there to become a world champion on the mat, but they are there to become a world champion off the mat, to be a better person, to succeed as a businessman, to learn some of the philosophy of jiu-jitsu. So there's a lot of things involved. And then we said before, the environment as well. For me, a great coach would create a great environment, because jiu-jitsu is very personal, it's very intimidating, very intimidating. When you come to jiu-jitsu, sometimes people come to train jiu-jitsu, they feel like they're butterflies on their stomach. And it can be really bad for the students, because the students think, I'm going to train with Steve. And Steve, he goes for the heel hook. When he goes for the heel hook, oh my gosh, he got some crazy heel hooks. So see that we were thinking about that. It's not a good environment. Instead of, you know, I know Steve, he got a good heel hooks, but because of the environment, he got a good control, great technique. I know if I get caught with that on my foot, he's not going to rip off my foot. And I want to train with Steve because I know I'm going to improve more. See the difference?
Yeah.
See the difference too. That's a great coach do. Great coach, that's what they do. They create a great environment. It's not just deliver great techniques. Because this one, maybe everybody can do it. They can deliver good techniques. But I don't know if they can build a good environment, a safe environment, which is like, I feel happy to be there every single day in training because I know that. The moment I shake hands with Steve, I know Steve has a good heel hooks. I know that we're telling Richard by shaking the hands that, hey, I'm going to take care of you and also you're going to take care of me. We are doing the agreement.
Mm.
The shaking hands is not like just slapping hands and bump fists. No, it means like, hey, listen, look in the eyes and then listen, I'm going to take care of you and also you're going to take care of me. Let's do it, let's roll, let's have fun.
That's really good. That's really interesting.
That's the idea. But people sometimes they get confused. They don't understand. And some coaches, they don't know how to deliver that. And the student, they get anxious. And then they don't want to train. I mean, they feel like when they get a blue belt, purple belt, or brown belt, they get, we have pride. I do have. All of us, we do. The ego steps in. And that's when we get hurt. Because we don't get a good environment, right, at the academy. The environment is that focus on improving, not improve. Not on proving. Folks always on improving, not on proving.
There's heel hooks are dangerous, and there's a lot of clubs that, because it's a trend now, there's a lot of clubs that just don't implement the right environment to be able to do it safely.
No.
A friend of mine, Jamie Hughes, who recently got his black belt, his academy is in Wales, and his coach, Greg Creel, as well. I went to visit recently, one of my guys was fighting on Cage Warriors in Wales. And I went and trained with Jamie, who I've known for years actually, and we kind of always fly out to the Europeans together, we used to. But his academy, they've got a system where they have like sweatbands, you know, like the bands you wear when you're doing a no-gi competition on your ankle. So there'll be three different colour bands, so beginner, intermediate, advanced. You roll to the highest level. But they've got a system with heel hooks when they're rolled in no-gi, it's just grab and hold and let go. And everyone in the room is in that agreement and it's a safe environment and everyone knows that, yeah, you're gonna jump for that heel hook and I'm gonna grab it, but that's it. So the guy that I'm, that when I'm attacking someone's legs, I'm jumping for it, he's not panicking. Like he'll defend. Once I've grabbed it, he stops defending it. Because I think that's that comes a problem, doesn't it? Like when you go for something like a heel hook or a foot lock or a toe hold or a knee bar, when you're training, people start defending it. So you start putting it on a little bit. And then they defend it a little bit more and you go a little bit more. So like I always tell people when I'm teaching them those kind of techniques, it's just like, if the guy's defending it, don't you have the ego? It's up to you now, because you're the one that has the control. You have the power.
Don't you think it's always the same guys and girls that always get injured by the heel hooks and the whatnot? It always seems to be the same candidates every single time. That, you know, but personally, I've been doing jiu-jitsu for about 10 years. I've been heel hooked numerous occasions. I've never, you know, popped an, I've touched wood, never popped like, you know, an ACL or anything like that. But there'll be some people who've been training for like 6 months, like, yeah, you know, my arm got popped, my ankle got popped, and it's like, is it the movement, or are we talking about the individual?
I know coaches that have popped their students' ankles and knees through heel hooks and toe holds, and it's the ego of a coach.
Ego,
yeah. You know?
Yeah.
So the environment is a big thing. Is there anything else?
You know, like I feel like just back to the heel hooks you're saying, my academy, what I do with my students, I ask them, what are your priorities? What do you want to do? Do you want to compete? Yeah, I want to compete probably in this format of heel hooks. Okay, so then, we need to work on that. You know, I'm doing jiu-jitsu for fun. I don't let them to read. Because again, why do you need to learn the heel hooks if you're not competing, right? If you're competing against those guys, you have to know how to defend, you have to know how to attack. Yes, on and on. But if you're not doing it for a competition, I don't allow to say, listen, like you said, even like we have the control, you know, it's because the ego, they're defending, oh, you know, he's defending, he should tap, you know, I'm gonna just put a little bit more pressure, that's pop, and one pops, that's one pop, it's over, it costs you a surgery sometimes, you know that, right, I mean, it's very dangerous. I do heel hooks, but again, at my academy, I tell my students, say, listen, ask your partner, ask him, say, listen, do you're familiar with the heel hooks? Yes, can we play safe around with that? But again, have the conversation. You guys are adults. We have like 40 people in class. Do you think I can keep babysitting each one of my students? I can't. I just tell them, say, listen, it's up to you guys. You only get hurt in jiu-jitsu if you want. If you want. If you don't want, I learn one thing. What I like to do, I do a verbal tap. I feel like, you know, it's getting a position, boom, boom. Instead of a tap, I don't have to tap. Let it go, that's it. And then we start again, the cycle again, go again and learn from that. So easy, I know sometimes people say, I mean, easy to say than done. I know that, but again, sometimes we have to learn. We have to. As soon as the reason why we leave our shoes off the mat, because our shoes are dirty. And it means what? If you bring our ego to the mat, it means what?
It's dirty.
Yes, same thing. That's the reason why I say, let's compare the shoes to your ego, exactly the same. Leave your ego off the mat, done. And then come in to keep it playful. And focus on learning, right? Focus on improving, not on proving.
Eammon, let's, for a few minutes, maybe five, 10 minutes, let's talk about coaching strategies. Let's finish off with that. How do you like to coach, and what are other coaches missing? What are they not doing?
That's a good question. So I just want to touch on something, you know, with the question that you asked Cobrinha first, because it's just been playing on my mind. I totally agree with everything Cobrinha said, and we talk a lot, and we're always trying to advance our ability to engage our students. I believe that coaches are not educating themselves, and I think that's the biggest problem here, that you have coaches that have been taught a way of engaging with their students and they just haven't evolved over 10 years. So the same formula they used 10 years ago, they haven't adapted it to today's standards. And you know, the greatest coaches, the ones that I communicate with, are always on that quest for knowledge. And I think it's very important that you're constantly reading and you're constantly refining. And I know that the next class I teach after this, the few days I've spent with Cobrinha, is going to be better than the ones I taught last week. And I'm not saying the ones I taught last week were bad, they're just going to be better. And that's exciting, the concept and that kind of idea that every time you're implementing something new into your class, a student is going to have a retention rate that was higher than before, or they're going to take more away from that lesson. That's going to affect them inside the mat, outside the mat, at home or at school. It's so exciting. And I believe that as coaches, we have to be on that quest for knowledge. We have to be on that quest for reading. We have to be on that quest for watching other great coaches. We have to be on the quest for just watching other leaders in general in life and see how they're leading and how they're persuading and how they're interacting with people and how they can inspire them. Because we have, the attention of a group of individuals for a short period of time. And within that short period of time, we have to impart on them as much information and as much knowledge and inspire them to go out and do great things. Not just within that hour and a half that they're on the mat or an hour that they're on the mat, but for a week that it can last with them. And it's something I say to the kids before we start every single kid session. Right, I've got you for 45 minutes. How much do you want to take away from this session that can transform the way that you interact at school, the way you do your homework, and the way that you communicate with your parents? And if that's important to you, then we can make it happen.
Yeah, look, you're very you self-assess a lot. Everybody here, I think, does. And that's a huge determining factor. After running a gym for a few years, we'd interview coaches, and the first thing we'd do is we'd get them coaching, like a trial session, so we'd see how they do. And we'd have certain things that maybe they could work on, whatever, as coaches or as instructors. But the defining thing for me was always they'd finish, and you'd ask them, so how did it go? And they'd go, if they went, yeah, great, went really well, then I know you're not the one for us. If you come away and say, I don't think this was quite right, this was, like Steve always asked me, how a session? I don't know. You have to ask the students. There'll be things I'll go away and I'll be assessing. I could have done that better. Could have done that better. We get some guys that just, they do a session. They could be at, it's always the ones that are pretty rubbish. How was it? Yeah, great. And they're not doing what you guys do.
Oh, win, lose or draw, you have to assess what went well and what went right. Even if you won. Even if you won the UFC title, you still have to address what went well and what didn't go well, so that what didn't go well doesn't happen again. And you have to be on that quest to make sure that you're perfecting. I always say to my team, we have to act like NASA. We have to look at every possible problem and have a solution for that problem. Because once you have that, then the variables of things going wrong is going to be very minimal. And then you're going to have black swan effects, which is an event that you don't know is going to go wrong until it goes wrong. And then you realize, wow, I never in my mind would have thought that being a problem until it actually happens. I mean, we have a process in place for if a hostile student enters a room and wants to fight another student from seeing an article where someone got killed on a mat. So it's now we're thinking outside of the box. Like, how would we deal with that if that happened here?
That's so rare.
Are we ready for that?
What is the process?
Oh, well, I'll have to go into detail with you afterwards.
But I'm saying that's not. I'm not saying the occasion's rare, because obviously the occasion's rare, but the fact that you've thought about that is being a professional.
Yeah, because it's happened somewhere else, and it's something you've never thought about until then.
You see coaching as you are professional about the way you coach, same as you with your Cobrinhas, where you coach, the way you conduct yourself is professional. At the end of the day, if you're looking to gain a living or a lifestyle from it, if I take my car to get serviced, I expect people to be thorough and professional. And yet when we go to things where we're charging money for a service, teaching something, we tend to not have to be professional. Whereas everybody here has that level of professionalism. So that's really good that you've thought about that.
I mean, for me, I just think leaders need three things. And I run a business as well, which employs, works with young people. And I believe as a leader, you have to be able to make decisions quickly. You have to. And you have to be able to be confident with those decisions. You have to be able to solve problems, big problems, problems that no one else can solve as a leader. And number three, you have to have awareness, because if you haven't got awareness, you're gonna miss everything else. So those three things for me as a leader is something I'm constantly, constantly, constantly working on, because I know that's what's gonna always keep me in this kind of position.
I think those hostile situations happen more than what people would think. I think like where I work at Fight for Peace it is a martial arts academy. We provide free boxing, judo, Brazilian Jiu Jitsu to young people, and it's free for them. But because of the area it's in, it's got a big gang culture. We often get people coming in looking for other people because they know they're going to be there. So I've had to do the same thing. I've had to put a process in place. It was only a few months ago that I was trying to help a young man that's been stabbed in the chest just above his heart, and he died an hour later in hospital. So it does happen. And I know the situation you're talking about, and you do have to be prepared for that. Because like you're saying, it's not just coaching on the mat, and you're saying about Life Champions. And that's actually a name of a course that I deliver through my work, Life Champions. I've given you the documents on that, haven't I? So maybe you can share that with him and he can have a look through it, Cobrinha. But it's you're providing a lot more than that. As a coach, you're so holistic. You're coaching the people here, but they might text you and say, oh, I'm not coming training, I'm having a bit of a rough day. So is your reply going to be, all right, see you tomorrow?
Is your reply going to be a middle finger emoji?
emoji
for you. To the side emoji.
For you, it's going to be the eyes.
Or are they literally going to see the two blue ticks and no response? Last seen today at 1921.
For you, it's going to be the eyes. For Zan, it's going to be the middle finger.
Yeah.
So I've been coaching coaches for about 5 years now. I've been delivering training to sports coaches across many different sports, and that's one thing I've noticed is the lack of willingness to educate themselves. They think because they have a level 2 qualification in boxing or coaching cycling, that's it, they're done. I've mastered it, I'm the best coach in the world now. And it's really not the case, is it? And reading is a big thing that I've picked up, and me and Eamon often share books that we're reading and things like that. And so let's finish off now on 3 books. So Eamon, I want you to tell me one book that sports coaches across the world should be reading right now that will benefit them in their sports coaching.
There's 2. So I'm going to try and pick, if I'm going to, can only give away one, it would have to be Coaching for Performance by John Whitman.
I saw you post that in the group the other day. I'm gonna read that one.
I refer to that book all the time.
Okay, Coaching for Performance. I'm gonna put all this in the show notes as well, so that you guys can kind of look them up. You said there was 2. Do you want to go to the other one?
Sports Hypnosis by Donald Leggett.
Sports Hypnosis. It's another one I haven't read.
Mm.
So my reading list is getting long. So one book I recommend is Accurate Thinking by Ruddy Ferguson. It's a really, really good book, and it breaks down strategies and concepts and methods that Ruddy Ferguson used to achieve Olympic success in judo. He's also a jiu-jitsu black belt, and he's also an MMA, he had 3 MMA fights I think on Strikeforce. But it's like 40 something, or maybe even older now, I guess. But that's a really, really good book.
Mm.
And I think you mentioned earlier, Cobrinha, about ownership. So there's a book I've just finished reading called Extreme Ownership by Jocko Willink. And that is a really, really good book. And it's very military heavy. And Jocko Willink has got a really good TED talk. And he opens up with the beginning, the intro of the book. And it's about a mistake that he made leading a group of Navy SEALs.
Mm.
And it's like, it's an amazing book. And it really makes you, it goes back to self-assessing. Like, I'm not the best coach in the world. What did I do wrong? You've got to take ownership over that rather than blaming somebody else. Cobrinha, any books that you recommend or podcasts or anything like that?
I'm with Emo. The one he recommended too.
Yeah.
Because he recommended to me as well. And I am on it.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing. Yeah. I'm definitely going to read those. I saw the Coaching Performance and I looked that up the other day, and it's definitely something I haven't dropped. Connor?
Well, for me, it's the book you're reading at the moment. The Talent Code really just changed my opinion on how people learn. The Talent Code's amazing. This guy travels the world looking for, like you were saying, what's the recipe for success? With regards to mindset, you want to look into maybe some famous athletes like Rafa Nadal. He has an amazing story of failure and success. I think for me, it's finding people that I find I can relate to. But in terms of books that will help me with coaching, the Talent Code really did help.
Yeah, I'm reading that at the moment. It's pretty good. And there's also one more, The Art of Learning.
Mm-hmm.
That I'm finding really interesting. I'm finding that really interesting at the moment. Just understanding how people learn differently, and it talks a lot about a chess champion. But that's a really good book as well that I think coaches really benefit from. Okay guys, so thank you so much. We've been going for an hour and 40 minutes now. And
thank you.
We could go all day. I could talk to your guys' stories all day. It's been amazing. Thank you so much for coming on.
Yeah, thanks. I honestly didn't expect to feel so inspired actually afterwards. Thanks for actually just a bit of wisdom. I feel like I've actually learned a lot from this, and I had a whole plethora of list of things I was going to try and get through and didn't even need to, man. You just started talking, I started listening, that was it. So thank you very much for
thanks guys for listening to our very first episode thank you. Of coaching
thank you guys thank you all right. for having me.
I know it's going to be hard to top that.
I think podcasts are quite selfish because time.
For our very first episode,
I'm doing this because I want to educate myself. I'm finding the best coaches in the world, and I'm bringing it into a room, and I'm taking it. I'm picking their
best
brains,
way.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
All right, guys. Until next time.
We
thank
hope
you.
That you learn even half as much as we learned during that hour and 45-minute segment. Great guy to talk to. Follow him on any kind of social media platform, YouTube. The guy. If you can go to one of his seminars, I would definitely highly recommend. Or even go watch him compete. Completely standout guy. And Eammon Madden, if you get a chance to go visit his gym, Aeon BJJ, that guy is an absolute master at what he does. And he was an absolute pleasure to talk to. I'm sure we'll get Eammon again at least once more in the future. If not, I'd love to have him down regular. There's much more to that man than the time allowed us to get into. Anyways, thanks for supporting us from the early days. Thanks for listening to our very first podcast. Big shout out to our sponsors that made this whole thing possible, coffeegram.com and The Body Kitchen. Thanks to you guys. You helped us put our dreams together. Okay, thanks guys. Next time.